Yeah, as I was saying, some of these verses we have to go back today by God's grace because the Bible is unsealed and we have to see how they relate to God's judgment on the church as well as the salvation of the body, the redemption of the body. Okay, but before that, tonight's study, Lord willing, we want to look at the unjust steward. Green Eyes, can you hear me? Do you have sound? We started looking at some of these verses. I know there were a couple of people in the room, and I got some feedback from them. And I appreciate the feedback because, as I mentioned before, I was holding on to this study for some time. I didn't want to offer a conclusion on it because I wasn't sure whether it was pointing to judgment or salvation or both. But I think tonight, by God's grace, based on some of the verses that I'm going to be sharing here, I'll try to offer right now what I believe these verses to be teaching. We start looking at this is the parable of the unjust steward that we read about in Luke chapter 16. Now, the first thing that we want to look at is the timing of it, okay, giving account. We read in verse 1, Luke chapter 16, and he said also unto his disciples, there was a certain rich man. Now, who is the rich man typifying? Anyone? When we read about a rich man in the Bible, isn't that normally pointing to, is that just some random rich man? Like the rich man in Lazarus, for example? Who do you suppose might be in view when God speaks of the rich man? Well, I know it's not a random rich man. Why? Because Christ spoke in parables, and a parable is spoken unto whom? Unto the house of Israel. So we have to look at these verses. These are actors, right? The rich man is an actor playing a certain part in the kingdom, in the body of Christ. So that's what we'll look at, in a few minutes. Nehemiah posted Revelation 3:17. Because thou sayest, I am rich. Yes, amen. So the rich man, I think, would be looking at the church. It is the corporate body of Christ. Now, more specifically, the unsaved body. Now, keep in mind that the believers, they too, they were a part of this body. When? Well, throughout the church age, let them both grow together until the harvest. At the time of harvest, I will say to the reapers, gather ye together first the tares. And the harvest has come. The harvest, I believe, is the separation of wheat and tares. Okay, now in verse 2, and he called him and said unto him, how is it that I hear this of thee? Give an account of thy stewardship. Now I'm going to propose again. Yeah, exactly, Israel. Before the separation, before the command to come out of Babylon, the wheat and tares are growing together. And now it is the harvest. God is allowing the unsaved, the dead, they bury the dead. They bury themselves. There's no hope of redemption or salvation for the unsaved body. But God is gathering, He is redeeming the elect. Come out of from my people, Babylon is fallen. Okay, so now the idea of giving account, I believe it is pointing to the day of the Lord. And when is the day of the Lord? When is the day of judgment? Was that May 21? You know, the Bible says, but of that day and hour knoweth no man. Yeah, exactly, Green Eyes. Not only, I mean, the day of the Lord has been here for some time, I believe. Now, I don't want to talk, get into numbers right now, but we can talk about the calendar later on. I do believe the calendar is accurate, but when we talk about the day of the Lord, it is primarily focusing on the great tribulation and the separation that follows. Again and again, the Bible says, in that day it shall come to pass, in that day. So if we make the day of the Lord May 21, well, what happened before that? Wasn't that the day of the Lord? The great tribulation, Babylon has fallen, for in 1 hour she is made desolate. Are there 2 hours in the Bible, 1 hour for the church and another hour for the world? No. It's the same hour. It's just that we have to, you know, look at these verses spiritually. Okay, so I say unto you that every idle word that men shall speak, they shall give account thereof in the day of judgment. Idle word, I believe, might be looking at the false gospels. Anytime we bring a message that is not faithful to the word of God, God today, he is judging the body. He forsakes the body. He does not bring revelation to them, the unsaved body. But it is the day of judgment, right? Time when God is judging his own people. So we see the timing of it. The day of the Lord, it begins with the great tribulation, the time when the two witnesses are killed, and then it transitions into the separation of wheat and tares. So now judgment is on the rest of the church, on Christendom. Exactly, he brings revelation to the believers. Now, 1 Corinthians 3 verse 13, now the believers, they went through the day of the Lord, right? The third part was refined in the fire. Judgment begins at the house of God. It is the chastening of the elect, the time when they're calling on his name. How long, O Lord, holy and true, that God would avenge them of their adversaries, the adversaries being the unsaved in the church. Again, the wicked, not those that are outside, but what's going on in the kingdom. So every man's work shall be made manifest. The day shall declare it. It shall be revealed by fire. God tries the believers in the fire, and then he brings revelation to them as he unseals the Bible. Okay, now, Luke chapter 16, verse 3. Let's continue. The steward said within himself, what shall I do? Now this guy, okay, I believe is typifying the unsaved body corporately. The believers are there prior to the separation. What shall I do? For my Lord taketh away from me the stewardship. Now, both saved and unsaved, they were stewards of what? Of the Word of God, right? Stewards of the Word of God. God had given the gospel to the church. Go ye into all the world with the gospel. So, just like the watchman, okay? The watchman is both the saved and the unsaved. So, God is going to take away the stewardship, which I believe is the language of judgment, from this, from the rich man. And he says, give an account. Now, notice what he says here. I am resolved. In other words, I know, okay, this is what I'm going to do. When I am put out of the stewardship, they may receive me into their houses. Well, that's kind of interesting because, first of all, we're looking at the body that is unsaved, and God is bringing judgment to the church. And now we have the same rich man, the unsaved body, who is going to perform an act so that those are the debtors that we're going to read about, they would receive him into their houses at a time when he is put out of the stewardship. So can you begin to see the language of salvation perhaps? Now in Acts chapter 28 verse 30, Paul dwelt 2 whole years in his own hired house and received all that came in unto him. So the idea of receiving, if you and I, we receive someone into the kingdom, it would mean that we share the gospel with them, and they do become saved, right? And yet at the same time, God, and that has to, you know, we have to, first of all, I think we have to be faithful to the whole counsel of God. And only God can allow us to be faithful. And notice in 2 John 1 verse 10, if there come any unto you and bring not this doctrine, receive him not into your house. So if someone is going to share a different gospel, one that is not being blessed by God, well then we're not to receive them. But that would not be the case of this unjust steward here, because he is anticipating that he is going to be received into their houses. Okay. Now, the next question I think we need to begin to ask, does he That's the church. Does the steward have the authority from God to modify the debt? To modify or to cancel a debt on behalf of the Lord. Now, who is the Lord? That's in view here in Matthew chapter 20, verse 8. Nehemiah writes, does not the unjust steward typify the church in Jesus' day? Well, not just in Jesus' day. What about the church today? What about the church that's always been around? You know, historically, yeah, the church, even the nation of Israel, back there when they came out of the land of Egypt, they typified, you know, the Bible says that these things are written for our admonition upon whom the end of the world is come. So God used them parabolically, historically, but spiritually they would be pointing to the kingdom of God that is the church that existed throughout the New Testament church age, and also in a time when God began to judge Babylon. So the unjust steward, yeah, we're looking at the corporate body, I believe. But notice here in verse 8, so when even was come the Lord of the vineyard. Now, even, that's an interesting word. The night cometh, remember, when no man can work. So now we're looking at the night. So the timing of this, it is God already coming. Christ is coming judgment for the church. So now the evening is come. The Lord of the vineyard saith unto his steward, call the laborers and give them their hire. It's interesting that it is the steward that is calling the laborers and then giving them their hire. The word hire there is the word reward. And it could be the reward of salvation, that is the crown of life. It can also be a reward of iniquity, a reward that is going to where the unsaved are going to end up in the lake of fire. Beginning from the last to the first, what's the principle of the Bible? The last shall be what? The reason I'm bringing this up is because I think we're going to read about this again later on. The last shall be first, and the first last. Yeah, the first, the church was first, but then now it has become last. And the believers were seen as the poor, the beggar, Lazarus. They were last. They were not being fed. But today, because God has redeemed them, now they receive the meat of due season. So they become first. Right? They come to be first. Whereas the church, who thought that she had all the riches of the world, but in reality she was blind. Just like Nehemiah posted earlier. Okay, so now keep that in mind. So they call the laborers, giving them their hire from the last unto the first. So I believe both salvation and judgment is in view here in Matthew chapter 20, verse 8. And the Lord said, who is that? Now, looking at the word steward, okay, just a couple of verses here. Who then is that faithful and wise steward whom his Lord shall make ruler over his household? God makes the church, he gives the church the authority to bind and to loose. Is that surprising? We're going to see this again in a few minutes. So he gives the church the authority. And in Colossians 1:25, I am made a minister according to the dispensation, that stewardship of God, which is given to me for you. And then in Matthew 16, verse 19, I will give unto thee the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatsoever thou shalt bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. Whatsoever thou shalt loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. So the church receives the key. It receives the authority to bring the gospel. It is acting on behalf of Christ. It is acting on behalf of God himself as it brings others into the kingdom. So it does, I believe, have the authority to forgive a debt. Because in essence, it would be Christ. If God is blessing this, it is really Christ who is forgiving the debt. Now we've seen this again and again, I believe, in the Bible. So Christ is the head of the body, and Christ is not separated from the church. I give unto you, the same thing here in Luke chapter 10, verse 19. Behold, I give unto you power to tread on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy. Hey, Mimos, welcome. We're looking at the parable of the unjust steward in Luke chapter 16, I believe. So I give unto you power to tread on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy. Well, what about you see that the thing is, Christ gives the believers, Jesus is not on earth, the believers are on earth. So he gives them the key in the sense that they are acting on behalf of the church. I'm sorry, they're acting on behalf of God. But hold that thought. Let me share the verses that I have here, and then I'll post the conclusion, and then later on we can open for a general discussion. We can address some of these. I have the keys of hell and of death. Yeah, Christ has the key, but we can't isolate verses from the Bible. We have to try and reconcile them, Lord willing, with everything else that the Bible is teaching. Like Matthew 16, verse 19, I will give unto thee the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatsoever thou shalt bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. Okay, so the authority. Understanding that the authority comes from God, but God uses those in the church and the body of Christ in order to accomplish his purpose. For example, today, the unsaved, the false prophets, God is using them. He gives them authority to deceive those who remain in darkness. Well, they are the one. Now, they don't realize this, of course, but if God is not bringing revelation to them, then certainly he is allowing the wicked to destroy the body. That's how God is judging the church, through the false prophets. They come with a deceptive gospel. Now, what about modifying? Let's look at the language here, Luke chapter 16, verse 5. So he called every one of his Lord's debtors unto him and said unto the first, how much owest thou unto my Lord? Now, and he said, 100 measures of oil. And he said unto him, take thy bill and sit down quickly and write 50. Now, first of all, two things that I thought were interesting here. The language of sitting down. Now, we're not going to spend much time on this. But there, I think, is the language of salvation. Sit down. Remember, Christ sat down on the right hand of God. And there's a lot of other information, I believe, in the Bible that would seem to relate that this is the language where one is actually being received of God, received of Christ. And also, the number 50, what number do you suppose is highlighted here in the number 50? Take thy bill, sit down quickly, and write 50. It would have to be the number 5, right? The number 5. 5 times 10 equals 50. Now the number 5, God uses numbers in the Bible. They are words, and they convey the gospel. Depending on the context, we can be looking at judgment, or we can be looking at salvation. In this context, I propose it is the latter. Okay, point 5 or the number 5. It is the fact that, you see, when this rich man, when this steward, he is modifying the debt, who is benefiting from this? Now, I know, there are a couple of different ways that others have looked at this parable. They're looking at the parable as one having worldly wisdom, or that this steward here is performing something that is wicked. And that is accepted by the world. That's the way of the world. Now, I think we have to be careful, Lord willing, because God is the one who defines the terms. And so we don't want to try to interpret this parable based on our own thinking, but rather search the Bible to see where the gospel would be, where the gospel lies. So the number 5 here, I believe it is pointing to salvation. What about the next phrase? God is highlighting another number here. In verse 7, then said he to another, how much owest thou? And he said, 100 measures of wheat. And he said unto him, Take thy bill and write fourscore. What is fourscore? Any mathematicians here? Nah, just. Yeah, exactly, Mosak. Thank you. 80. So what number is highlighted here? What is the number? Well, the number 8. The number 8. Isn't that interesting? Now, that didn't come to mind before. The number 8, if we search the Bible, how many were on the ark when God saved Noah and his family? Don't we read that there were 8 souls on the ark? And a lot of other verses, I think, that I could offer that would seem to show that the number 8 is a number that relates to salvation. Okay, it relates to salvation. Those in the old days, they had to be circumcised at the when they were 8 days old. So I think it's interesting that God is using the number 80 here, as when we look at the debt that is modified by the steward. Okay, so it is a number 8. So there again, I think would be additional perhaps evidence, Lord willing, to show that no, this unjust steward, as I'm going to offer in a few minutes, is not doing anything wicked. If anything, it's just the opposite. He is forgiving. He is modifying the debt of the debtors. And that's exactly what the Bible calls for us to do. It calls for us to forgive our neighbors, our debtors, right? We read this in the Lord's Prayer. Forgive us our debt as we forgive our debtors. So he is acting on behalf of Christ, on behalf of God. And so he is modified. Now keep in mind what he said earlier, that he is going to be put out of the stewardship, but he wants to make sure that when that happens, that the debtors would receive him into their houses. So there again, and I think God makes a connection when he speaks of making friends of with the unrighteous mammon. Okay, Proverbs 19, verse 17. He that hath pity on the poor lendeth unto the Lord. And the idea of having pity on the poor, you know, we don't want to look at that as, you know, you see someone outside, you give them a dollar. Is that what this is talking about? You feed someone, someone in need, someone who is homeless. Well, there's nothing wrong with doing that, right? Morally. Is it wrong? Is it a sin if you give someone money on the street? Yeah, exactly, Israel. Because God speaks in parables. So we don't want to look at these verses on the earthly level. We have to see, Lord willing, how they relate to the kingdom. What is God telling us concerning salvation? We know that the believers are poor, just like the beggar Lazarus. They were not being fed, but the rich man is believes to have all the blessings of the world. Exactly. Thank you, Teacher 19. Blessed is the poor in spirit. The poor in spirit. Matthew 25, verse 40. And the king shall answer and say unto them, Verily I say unto you, inasmuch as ye have done it unto one of the least of these my brethren, ye have done it unto me. Luke chapter 7, verse 41. There was a certain creditor which had two debtors. That's the parable of the unforgiving servant. Now we see in this parable, God brought judgment on the unforgiving servant because, first of all, he forgave him the debt. That's the church. Now, it doesn't mean that the church became saved. It is corporately identified with Christ. God speaks of redeeming corporately the body. Christ paid for their sins. And then God speaks of removing the Holy Spirit from them. That's the language of judgment. But the Bible teaches many are called, but few are chosen. So we have to see which ones ultimately are identified with Christ. And these would be the believers today who respond to the command, Babylon is fallen, come out over my people. Okay, so he frankly forgave them both. And then in verse 32, Matthew chapter 18. Then his Lord, after that he had called him, and said unto him, O thou wicked servant, I forgave thee all that debt, because thou desirest me. Should it not thou also have had compassion on thy fellow servant, even as I had pity on thee? So you see, he did not forgive. In other words, he is not being faithful to the word of God. He is not sharing of the gospel. He is the rich man. So the idea of forgiving one another, right? It's not really talking about forgiveness in a sense, or, you know, I forget about something that you did to me, but rather we want to be faithful. We want to share the gospel. We want, as God would reveal it, of course, we want to share the true gospel, because the moment we begin to share the false gospel, as we see today, confusion, then it means we are not forgiving. Why? Well, because if we bring a different gospel, no one is going to become saved. God is not going to bless that gospel. So we're not forgiving, right? We're not forgiving. But when we share the true gospel by God's grace, and God is able to bless that message, and someone does become saved, well, then we in ourselves, we have forgiven this individual. Can you see how it's not really myself or yourself forgiving the individual, but rather it is God himself? So again, the church, I believe, the steward, has the authority to act on behalf of Christ. Okay, so now this this did not forgive his brother, and God, the rest of the parable, we read about God calling for him to be cast into prison and until he should pay all the debt. 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 10. As every man have received a gift, even so the minister the same one to another as good stewards of the manifold grace of God. The stewardship, again, I propose it is the body of Christ. It is the church prior to the separation. Now today we have another stewardship, which would relate to what? To the believers, right? New heavens and a new earth, new Jerusalem. The former is not remembered. God brings judgment to Babylon. All right, let's move on to, you know, I have quite a few verses. If I'm going a little too fast, please stop me. But I'm trying not to drag the study so that it doesn't become too long. But by the same token, I want to make sure that you guys are at least having some time to look at or digest some of the verses that I'm posting here. Now, God commanded the unjust steward in verse 8, Luke chapter 16. And the Lord commanded the unjust steward because he had done wisely. For the children of this world are in their generation wise, not wiser. The word that is translated wiser there, it is always translated wise. And I think somehow the translators, they may have had some difficulty with this. So they made this wiser than the children of light. Well, that would not be possible, because the children of light here again is referring to the elect. It is referring to the believers. And if the unjust steward here is a picture of someone who is going to be converted, well, then he too would be a child of light. Does that make sense? So the Lord commanded the unjust steward because he had done wisely. Why? Why would God command this man here, who just told one of the debtors, how much do you owe? 100 pence. Okay, scratch that, write 50. What about you? 100 measures of wheat. And then he said, well, scratch that and write 80. So the question is the unjust steward sinning, or is he being a good steward? Now we know he was a bad steward, because God said that he had wasted his good, and that's what happened to the church. But then the church is converted when? At the revelation of Christ. Nehemiah writes 1 Corinthians 4, 1-2. Let a man so account of us as the ministers of Christ and stewards of the mysteries of God. Yes, amen. Thank you, Nehemiah. I think I had that verse. I'm not sure. I may have removed it, but yeah, it does apply, I believe. Okay, so the steward has to be faithful. So the question is, this unjust steward, was he being faithful? at a time when he modified the debt of these debtors? Who is benefited from this? Who do you suppose is benefiting from the fact that he reduced the debt? Who benefits from it? Anyone? Is he stealing? That's what I've heard others refer to, the fact that he is being deceptive. He is stealing his Lord's money by doing this. But is that really the case? Does the Bible mention anywhere here that he is stealing from his master? When he modified the debt, who benefits? I mean, just think about it. Here you owe someone $100, and then someone else comes along and they say, well, actually, I'm gonna reduce the debt. Yeah, exactly, teacher 19. The person who owed the debt, the debtor. Because if I have to pay someone $50 instead of $100, well, I benefit from it. So now the question is the unjust steward, is he doing good or evil for the debtor? Now, we know the debtor from other language in the Bible. God speaks of someone having two debtors. Forgive us our debt as we forgive our debtors. So if the debtor is benefiting from it, then I believe it's really looking at the fact that the unjust steward here, he is doing something good, not evil. Does that make sense? Even though on the surface, from our perspective, he appears to be cheating. He appears to be doing something that is contrary to his Lord. But then again, why would the master, and the master there would have to be whom? The Lord that said that he was going to put him out of the stewardship. Is that talking about someone more wicked than himself? Who is the Lord that's in view? Well, it has to be God, right? It has to be Christ. So we read here in verse 8, and the Lord commanded the unjust steward because he had done wisely. For the children of the world, of this world, are in their generation wise. Now the word then there again, it is all, for the most part, maybe like 80% of the time, it's translated for. Sometimes it's translated above or beyond. And I think it's really carrying the message of being worthy to be. In other words, this unjust steward is worthy of being a child of light. Not that he is wiser than the children of light, but he appears to be identifying with the children of light. Does that make sense? And that would seem to relate. That would seem to be consistent with what's in view here. God is commanding the unjust steward because he had done wisely. Yeah, exactly, because his works are good. He is forgiving. Now, the debtor is benefiting from it. And spiritually, if someone is benefiting from it, it means that they are becoming saved. So this unjust steward here, I think, is a picture of someone really looking at the church that is doing something good. And because of this, under the authority of Christ, God is going to redeem the church. Nehemiah writes, 1 Peter 4:10, as every man have received a gift, even so minister the same one to another as good stewards of the... Yeah, amen. You know, you're sharing a lot of very good verses, I believe. Very interesting verses. And there again, I hope we can see that the command of the Bible is that we have to be good stewards. We have to forgive our brother, our debtors. As in God, in turn, he would forgive us. Now, in the parable of the unjust, the unforgiving servant, that didn't happen. And that would be a picture of the church killing the two witnesses in tribulation. But here, this unjust steward, I believe he is doing something positive, and that's why God is applauding, God is commanding him. That verse didn't post. Hold on 1 second. And I think we're going to see more of this in a few minutes, Lord willing. Proverbs chapter 12, that's what I want to post. That's not on the screen, is it? Proverbs chapter 12, verse 8. I don't think it is. Let me try to. I may have to break it up. Okay. Thanks. A man shall be commanded according to his wisdom. You see the tie in there? But look at the contrast. He that is of a perverse heart shall be despised. So there again, I propose that this unjust steward here is commanded of God because he had done wisely. A man shall be commanded according to his wisdom, but he that is of a perverse heart, that would be those who remain unsaved in the body, they shall be despised. And here's another verse. Take a look at 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 12. For we dare not make ourselves of the number or compare ourselves with some that command themselves. Now God has to command the body. We don't command ourselves. But they measuring themselves by themselves and comparing themselves among themselves are not wise. See that? So the moment that the word, the focus is on me, feeding those who feed not the flock, if anything, they kill them that are fed, they feed themselves. So these are not wise. But this unjust steward here, it seems that he receives the blessing of God. Now, here's an interesting area, Lord willing. Let's take a look at this topic here. Making friends with the mammon of unrighteousness. What is the mammon? Mammon, I think we see it relates to money. It relates to treasure. Is it surprising that God would refer to the rich man as, would refer to the church as the rich man? Trusting in his treasures, trusting in his money. What do you suppose it means? Yeah, exactly. What do you suppose it means to make friends? Well, let me go ahead and post the verse. Not sure if it'll post. Luke chapter 16, verse 9. And by the way, look at the connection here with the very first verse I think I posted, Luke chapter 16. And I say unto you, make to yourselves friends of the mammon of unrighteousness, that when ye fail, they may receive you. Well, that's what the unjust steward said, right? Let me modify these debts so that when I'm put out of the stewardship, they would receive me into their houses. Well, God is saying the same thing here, I believe, in the context of making friends with the unrighteous mammon. So in other words, the unjust steward was not really doing something that was evil. If anything, he was making friends. He was relating to the mammon of unrighteousness in the sense that he was forgiving someone else. He is forgiving his debtors, right? He modifies a debt on behalf of his Lord. So make thee yourselves friends. So now let's take a look at the earthly picture, and then I'll see if I can try to relate what I believe the spiritual picture is looking at. You see, what happens if you have money? You have a lot of money, okay? Now, money in itself is not evil, is it? What does the Bible have to say about that? Is money evil? Yeah, exactly. It's not money that's evil. It's the love of money. It's what we do with our money that shows the intent of our heart. Now, before we get to that, hold on to that thought. Let's look at the word fail there, because the tie in there, the timing of it, I think, is pointing to the God's judgment on Babylon. Luke 22, verse 32. But I have prayed for thee that thy faith fail not. The word faith there, I believe, is relating to Christ. When the faith fails, it means that God has brought judgment. God the Holy Spirit is not in the midst. He brings judgment to the body. So that would be the time when God is judging Babylon. And that's what happened at the very beginning. The unjust steward, right? He was going to be put out of the stewardship. And so the faith is going to fail. So when ye fail, in other words, when the church comes into the great tribulation and God begins to judge the church, they may receive you. See that? He was concerned that he would be received into everlasting habitation. So there again, it's in the context of making friends with the mammon of unrighteousness. Let's see. Okay, so now you have lots of money. Now what happens if you use this money in order to share the gospel and others become saved? Well, you have used the money wisely. Is that not correct? Isn't that what we've been taught? That's what I heard Mr. Camping teach one time. Yeah, so you would be blessed. You have lots of money. Doesn't mean just because you have money, you are wicked. But if you use the money wisely, in a sense that you use the money to further the kingdom of God, and those through this activity, others do become saved. So now you have made friends, it seems, with the mammon of unrighteousness. Now the mammon of unrighteousness, spiritually, it is pointing to the church. It is pointing to the false gospels. So the rich man, if someone is rich, well, they're rich in their own eyes. They believe they have the truth. They believe they have the gospel, but in reality, they are poor. So the same is in view here. The moment that the church, if the church is being faithful to the whole counsel of God, if the church is feeding the flock, then the church is making friends. The church is using its riches not to condemn or to deceive others, but rather to bring others into the kingdom. Can you see the tie in there? That, I believe, is a beautiful spiritual picture, Lord willing. So when God says to make yourselves friends of the mammon of unrighteousness, it is the fact that we don't trust in our own riches. We use our riches. We use the gospel that God has given to the body. God has made the body stewards of the gospel. By using it faithfully, in essence, we are making friends with the mammon of unrighteousness, so that now, when the church comes into the great tribulation, when judgment comes on Babylon, others, those who do become saved, they would receive us into everlasting habitation. When thy faith fails. So that's what we read here. Let's look at some verses having to do with how one is to handle the riches. Matthew 19, verse 21, Jesus said unto him, if thou wilt be perfect, go and sell that thou hast and give to the poor. Now, God is not telling someone to sell your earthly possessions, is he? No, because the Bible is a spiritual book. God is speaking in parables. So we don't want to be caught up in looking at how these verses relate physically, but rather spiritually. Giving to the poor, again, it has to do with sharing the gospel. 1 Timothy 6:17, charge them that are rich in this world that they be not high-minded, nor trust in uncertain riches, but in the living God. Those that are rich, God there, I believe he is looking at the church. Those who say they are rich, they're feeding themselves like the rich man, not feeding the beggar Lazarus. He's not being faithful to the whole counsel of God. Verse 18, that they do good, that they be rich in good works. You see how God is defining the terms? They be rich in good works, ready to distribute, willing to communicate. Communicate what? What are they to communicate? Yeah, exactly, Gregory. The gospel. The Bible. Everything is focusing, I believe, on the gospel. It is, that's what the spiritual nature of it is about, I believe. Luke chapter 16, verse 10, he that is faithful in that which is least is faithful also in much. Yeah, exactly, Nehemiah, the true gospel. But you see here, God is continuing, I believe that we're still looking at the same context. He that is faithful in that which is least. So was the unjust steward, was he faithful in something that was least? Yes, I believe he was. And because of this, he is going to be faithful in much. And the opposite is true. He that is unjust in the least is unjust also in much. So there again, I think God is looking at the rich man or the unjust steward as doing something positive. Luke chapter 16, verse 11. If therefore ye have not been faithful in the unrighteous mammon, who will commit to your trust the true riches? And who is that? What are the true riches that are ultimately in view? That would have to be Christ, right? He has the true riches. He has salvation. Nehemiah posted Luke 16, verse 2. And he called him and said unto him, how is it that I hear this of thee? Give account of thy stewardship, for thou mayest no longer be steward. Yeah, exactly. Well, God is about to cast the church out of the stewardship. And then this unjust steward began to take action. That, I believe, is a picture of the redemption of the body. But we can talk a little bit, we can talk some more about that in a few minutes. We have to look at other verses that would tie in, or you know, allow us to perhaps understand what the collective salvation or the redemption of the body is really looking at. Luke chapter 16, verse 13, no servant can serve two masters. Either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will hold on to the one and despise the other. Ye cannot serve God and mammon. So let me ask you the question. Based on everything that we're looking at here, the unjust steward, has he been faithful with the unrighteous mammon? Is he faithful with the unrighteous mammon? Well, I think so, because God commands him, first of all, and then he speaks of the fact that, in the same context, make friends with the mammon of unrighteousness. And that's what he did, I believe, when he forgave. He modified the debt of the debtors. That, I think, is a picture of sharing the gospel, right? Being forgiven, forgiving to his debtors. And then Matthew chapter 6, verse 19. Lay not up for yourselves treasures upon earth, where moth and rust doth corrupt, and where thieves break through and steal. Is that talking about earthly possessions? On the moral side, maybe, yeah. Yeah, we don't want to put our trust in our houses, our cars, our money, because these things are temporary. They're going to pass away, if anything. And then you have the thieves. Someone can come in, they can break into your house, and then they rob you of your riches. So yeah, God is looking at the earthly image as well. But more importantly, we want to understand these verses how. We want to make sure that we understand these verses spiritually. Well, Nehemiah, yeah, spiritually. If that's the case, well, then you have to, you know, explain with the Bible why God is commanding the unjust steward. You have to explain why it is in the same context that, all right, hold on to that thought. All right, let me finish sharing some of these verses, and then, you know, we can try to elaborate on that. Matthew chapter 6, verse 21, for you, where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. Okay, so we don't want to be rich. We want to be friends with the mammon of unrighteousness. In other words, we want to use the gospel faithfully. We want to forgive for the love of money. That's the verse we're talking about earlier. The love of money is the root of all evil. Okay, not money itself. Now, the last thing I want to look at, and I didn't even realize this, you know, there's a parable just before the parable of the unjust steward, and that's the parable of the prodigal son. Now notice the similarities here. Okay, now in this parable, God makes it a little easier to see how the one son who wasted his substance, he came back to his father and he was accepted, he was redeemed. In verse 12, the younger of them said his father, said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that falleth to me. And he divided unto them his living. Verse 13, and not many days after, the younger son gathered all together and took his journey into a far country and wasted his substance. Same language. Wasted. What happened to the unjust steward? What do we read about the unjust steward? He wasted his goods. And because of this, he feared that he would be put out of the stewardship. Right? Now notice here, he wasted his substance with riotous living. That's the language of Babylon. That's the rich man. Okay, he is rich in his own eyes. Riotous living, it has to do with fornicating, bringing a different gospel, not being faithful to the whole counsel of God. And that's where all of us were prior to God redeeming the body. Luke chapter 15, verse 14. And when he had spent all, there arose a mighty famine in that land. What is a famine pointing to? What do you suppose the famine? Remember Amos chapter 8? Behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that I will send a famine in the land. Yeah, exactly, teacher 19, the lack of the word. It's the great tribulation. It's God's judgment. So the same judgment that the unjust steward had come into. The same judgment that the unjust steward had come into at a time when God was judging Babylon. Titus 1:7-9, for a bishop must be blameless, steward of God, not self-will, but a lover of hospitality, a lover of good men, sober, just, holy, temperate, holy, fat, they may be able to... Okay, yeah, hold on to that thought. Almost done. Not a problem, Israel. Luke chapter 15, verse 18. I will arise and go to my father. By the way, you know, before we challenge or we offer correction, let's try to see if whether or not, first of all, we look at the verses that are offered and then see if we can relate them to the Bible, the whole Bible. Because we have to bring the whole Bible into focus. Otherwise, you know, if we isolate verses from the Bible, then a number of things can happen. You know, many people, they develop doctrines based on one or two verses from the Bible. But notice here in verse 20, Luke chapter 15, we're looking at the prodigal son. And he arose and came to his father, but when he was yet a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion. He had compassion. Well, isn't that the language of salvation, right? Even though he wasted his substance. Verse 21, and the son said unto his father, I have sinned against heaven and in thy sight, and am no more worthy to be called thy son. What did the unjust steward say? I cannot dig to beg. I am ashamed. So there again, he is looking at the, he is recognizing his what? Does the church recognize its shame today? See, the prodigal son, he realized that he wasted his substance. So he is admitting that, right? He admits the fact that he has sinned. Yeah, exactly. The church does not realize that. So the church is not ashamed. The church is not going to, return to God. The idea of this son here returning to his father, it is the fact that he repents. And that's what happens to the believers. They repent in a sense that God is going to deliver them. He redeems them from the unclean body. Right? Babylon is fallen, come out of her, my people. So he admits the fact, just like the unjust steward, he admitted the fact that he is ashamed. Right? And he was concerned that he would be put out of the stewardship, and therefore he went ahead and did something positive, which received God's approval in a sense that he forgave the debtors, right? He modified the debt, which benefited not him. He didn't benefit from it. I'm not aware that, any verses that would suggest that he benefited, financially from this transaction, right? Does that make sense? If anything, those who received the modification, they had to pay less. And that, I believe, is the language of the fact that they are forgiven, right? Like they're forgiven the debt. Almost done. Just last verse here. And we see here in verse 23, Luke chapter 15, bring hither the fatted calf and kill it, and let us eat and be merry. For this my son, now I do believe there's a very direct parallel between this parable and the unjust steward. My son was dead. The church was dead. The two witnesses were killed coming into the great tribulation, right? My son was dead and is alive again. When does that happen? When Christ is revealed. God begins to unseal the Bible, and the Holy Spirit is poured out a second time unto Revelation. Now we understand the nature of God's judgment on the church. It's not about how God is judging the world. God is not looking at the world. We're not saying that God is not going to, or he doesn't have something planned for the unsaved of the world. But as far as how we relate to these verses, I believe it is altogether primarily looking at what's going on in the kingdom. God, it seems, he was always concerned with the wickedness that was going on in the body of Christ itself. Ms. T.S., hi, welcome. Just finishing up a study here. I'm going to go ahead and post the conclusion. Have to post it in two parts. That's part one. And then we can open for a general discussion. So the parable of the unjust steward who was commanded of God for modifying the debt of the Lord's debtors appears to be pointing to the redemption of the church in tribulation. You know, just like the prodigal son, he wasted his substance, and then he was feeding swine, and then he realized, and he said, well, let me go back to my father. Perhaps he would have mercy on me. And that's exactly what happened. His father called for the fatted calf, which identifies, I believe, with Christ. The fact that now he has a sacrifice, and God welcomes him back. My son was dead and is alive again. Now the believers, they too, corporately, not individually. Individually, God seals the 144,000. Hurt not the earth, neither the sea, nor the trees, till we have sealed the servants of our God in their foreheads. Individually, they are redeemed. But corporately, remember the wheat and tares are growing together. They're part of the unclean body. That's why they had to be refined. That's why they had to be redeemed. Because the body, it's like, you know, your body or my body. We long for the time when, at the very last day, God would give us a new body. That's on the physical side, the literal side, when the believers would receive a body that is not going to sin. So it's spiritually, though, it's looking at the church as a whole, the body of Christ. God redeems that body. And I think there's some verses in the book of Romans that speak of God's redeeming the body, or the redemption of the church itself. Those who groan within themselves, waiting for the adoption of the children of God, the redemption of the body. So, God calls for the body to be faithful in the unrighteous mammon, which seems to relate to putting the riches of the church to good use. In doing so, the body forgives debts as they properly feed the flock. And that's what I believe, Lord willing, that the unjust steward, he started off as unjust, he started off as being rich. But take a look at this verse right here. Such were some of you. And 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 11. That's all of us prior to salvation. God, in the verse prior to that, God began, he was talking about, be not deceived, the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God, neither fornicators, idolaters, adulterers, effeminates, abusers of themselves with mankind, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners shall inherit the kingdom of God, and such were some of you. Corporately, all of us. Now, can any of us say that we were not? Let me maybe rephrase that. Can any of us say today that we were faithful to the Word of God prior to the revelation of Christ? Did we have things figured? Yeah, of course not. We were talking about hell and eternal damnation. When it comes to judgment the day of the Lord. We always thought it was going to be the very last day. So a lot of verses in the Bible that we were not understanding spiritually. And so we were not being faithful to the whole counsel of God. And the church, the body itself, including the elect, the church corporately came under the wrath of God. That's the sword that came on the church. The wound came on the church and tribulation. And now God heals the wound of the body. The deadly wound is healed. And that, I believe, it has to do with the elect coming out of Babylon. Okay, let me go ahead and turn off the recorder, and then we'll open for a discussion.